Let me greet you in the name of our Savior, Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. Our God is good. Amen. Our God is good. Amen. Hallelujah. Let me take this time to thank my father. Forgive me this opportunity to share the word of God, to share the heart of God with his church. Amen. Hallelujah. The theme for this message is preparing for the coming of the Lord. Amen. Let me also recognize the presence of the elders in the house. Our mother, Mamuruti, the board, all of them. Amen. I also recognize the presence of my wife. Amen. the queen of my kingdom. I heard someone saying this. Amen. Hallelujah. Yeah, I'm going to take my time to present what the Lord has given me. Amen. The Lord has been talking to me about his coming. This has been really, you know, heavy in my heart. Yet I feel I'll be relieved from here. Amen. Preparing for the coming of the Lord. God wants to prepare us for the coming of his Son. Many years ago, when I got born again, I still found people still saying the Lord Jesus Christ is coming. And he's still coming. Amen. And the question is, is the church ready now? Amen. So all the messages which have been preached ever since as far as we can remember, God has been preparing us, actually. Especially the messages which have been preached in this assembly. And I believe we are so privileged to be in this house, in this church. And trust me, if you are in tune with what the Lord is doing right now, you will not miss anything in this church. Amen. And we also talked about revival. We've been talking about revival, and revival is coming. In the last days, there's going to be revival. You remember when Haggai says, the glory of the latter house shall be greater than of the former. You know the scripture, Haggai 2:9. Amen. Now, the question is the church ready for the coming of the Lord? Sometimes, we just do things, we as the church, we relax. But when he appears, when the Lord Jesus Christ shall appear, he shall appear in a setup like this one, whereby people will just be shocked. Amen. The Lord Jesus Christ talked about the signs of his coming. That when we say he's about to come, some things will happen. Amen. Muruti, let me ask you to pray for the word of God.
Father, we want to thank you for your servant this morning, O God. We know that you have anointed him, you have called him, Heavenly Father, for a time like this. Mighty God, as your servant gives us the word this morning, may your anointing flow from him to us. Mighty God, may we hear what the Spirit is saying to us, O God. May the power of the risen Christ be operating on him, Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus. We know that you are able to do exceedingly, abundantly above all that we could ever think of, imagine, or even ask for. May you do exceedingly this morning, O God, as your servant speaks to us about your coming, Jehovah. Father, we want to thank you for this. It's a blessing that you have given to this church, O God. And we want to enjoy that blessing this morning. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Maruth. Let us go to Matthew chapter 24 from verse 1 up to 21. We'll just read the long passage. It says, "And Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, See you not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. Verse 3. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, Tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of the coming and of the end of the world? Amen. I think you can pick that indeed there is an end. So the disciples came to Jesus Christ. They wanted to know to know about the signs and to know when is the end. Amen. Verse 4 says, And Jesus answered and said unto them, Take heed that no man deceive you. For men shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. For many shall come, verse 6, and you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. I think we can relate now this passage. What is happening now? We have heard when he says we shall hear rumors of war. Verse 7, he says, For nations shall rise against nations. Amen. I think you are up to date with the news. The issue of xenophobia is not a joke. And many things are still coming. For nations shall rise against nations. Verse 7. And kingdoms against kingdoms. And there shall be famines and pestilence and earthquakes in diverse places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Amen. Is the church ready for his coming? Now you hear the Lord Jesus Christ says, this will be the beginning of sorrows. It means there are many things that are coming. Amen. Let me continue reading. Then I want to read and finish the whole passage. Verse 9. Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted and shall kill you. And you shall be hated of all the nations for my name's sake. And then shall many be offended and shall betray one another and shall hate one another. We already see this in churches. Not only in churches though, but not only in the world, but also in churches. That people have started betraying others. Let's go to verse 11. And many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. And because of iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. And in church now, the love of God has, grown cold. Let us trust ourselves as a church. Just last week, as the xenophobia was in the church, people were taking sides. Then I realized that we are evil human beings. And then I realized also that during the time when the Lord Jesus Christ was crucified, maybe I should have also, be part of those who were crucifying because of the evil in humanity. Until there is a revelation, then we will know what is happening. Amen. Let me go to verse 20 because it's long. I trust that you will read the passage at home. But pray that your flight be not in the winter, neither on the Sabbath day. Amen. This is where we realize that the Lord Jesus Christ is coming to take his church. There is what is called rapture, the rapture of the saints, whereby the saints are going to be raptured. Amen. I preached this type of message at the Kotebelelong.
Amen. Such as this at the memorial service, and people could not understand me.
Amen. I think Mawuti remember that. But I think the church will remember, will actually understand this. That there's going to be a time when the Lord Jesus Christ will appear to take his church. Amen. But only those who are born again are going to be taken. When you read the book of Revelation, the whole of it, they say there's going to be the first intake of rapture. So it's good that when rapture happens, you are taken first. Because in verse 21 it says, for then shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time. Amen. I pray that Christians are ready. That when God raptures his church, all Christians will go. But all hypocrites are going to remain behind.
All hypocrites will remain behind.
Amen. Now, God loves his people so much. Does not want any of us to perish. Amen. Last year, when our pastor was teaching about the theme, who are you, for a very long time, I started to realize who I am then. That I'm supposed to be what I'm supposed to be. I'm supposed to be what the Lord wants me to be. This is one of the messages which I believe that this message was preparing me. This theme was preparing me. Right now, we are talking about the stronghold of the mind. Yes. The stronghold of the mind. Amen. It shows that God is preparing, he's doing everything to make sure that his church is ready. Amen. Paul in Ephesians 15-17, he says, be very careful. Then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Amen. It is the time for the church to redeem the time. God is worried about his people. There's something that God is after in us. You remember, we were created in the image of God. Therefore, the image of God in us is what God is after. Let me give you an example about the Americans. The American nation. When one of their own is stuck in, or maybe at war, a soldier is stuck, or they are dead at war. Even if it's just one person, they will make sure that they will take him. They will make sure that they will send some people to go and fetch his body if he's dead. Amen. Because they believe that this person is part of them. Now about God. God that these people that were created in His image. The image of God, which is the Spirit of God in us. God sees Himself when He looks at this image. That is why God is after us every time, you know, He's giving us more time to repent. Amen. Because when he created us in His image, and He knew that we are the only creatures who understand Him. Amen. I'm always thinking, you know, when Paul says the creation is waiting.
In eager
to see the sons of God being revealed. It shows that the image of God in us, God really takes care of that. That His image in us. Amen. He wants to care of that image. So the creation, when it looks at us, it sees,
you
know, the wonderfulness of God. Because the creation sees the image of God in us. The creation is groaning. It feels that it is under the persecution of the evil world. And the creation is really waiting in expectation that the sons of God, those who carry the image of God, shall redeem me. But there is nothing. I always picture the creation when, you know, a child of God is coming out of the house prepared, you know, when a child of God steps on this ground. I always imagine the creation of God saying, wow. Wow. And we pray the creation. Hallelujah. You are doing well, Mr. Tebo.
Yeah,
be encouraged. Amen. The creation. It feels pain, dear Lord. And disappointed. Because the creation really expected a lot from the you know, this creature which bears the image of God. And then the children, they don't know these things. That, you know, the image of God means a lot in us. Amen. And we perish. I mean, they perish. Amen. When He says, for, you know, my people perish. In Hosea chapter 4, verse 6, where He says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject them. Amen. You see, now this is where the free will of the human being comes in. That when God redeem His church, or when God, you know, shall rapture His church, he's going to base on what our free will is. What our free will wants. Amen. And I want you to know that lack of knowledge, I once said this, lack of knowledge because of ignorance is sin. Amen. So is the church ready? Hallelujah. So salvation is our portion. Last week, my pastor, I love my pastor so much. That is why every time I always refer to what he said. And I have learned a lot from him. I think he's gone. Oh, I wanted to say this word in his absence. But I've learned a lot. I was shocked someday. I didn't tell you that the Bible school has called me to lecture. I've been lecturing in the Bible school. I've started, I have 2 months now. So, the first day when I arrived there, I didn't know that I've been rubbing some anointing from my pastor. And I also want to you to know that because you sit under this man, you rub that anointing, you will be shocked. And I started to encourage the pastors. Amen. I started to encourage them, telling them about the goodness of the Lord. I was encouraging them that the sheep or what they are doing right now, they should not quit. They are doing a good job. And when I'm saying this is the anointing, the spirit of my pastor is the one that is speaking. I learned something recently that when Elijah was saying, I want you to give me the double portion of your anointing. Some scriptures, some versions, they said your spirit, double portion of your spirit. Trust me. After I encouraged the pastors, I was not teaching. I was just talking to them. It was the first day. I was just telling them about ministry and what God does things out there. And then when we finished, I started praying. Then I realized, this is a secret. I've been rubbing the anointing. Amen. So, salvation is our portion as children of God. I want to rush through four things that you must do to prepare for the coming of the Lord. Number one is salvation. Amen. That you should be born again. I realized that not all people in the church, not all people that you see come to church are born again. Hey, you'll be shocked. Okay, this message is just to help us introspect ourselves with the relationship. Our relationship with our Father. Amen. First John 5.
John 1.
This one says, whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. Amen. And there are many people who do not believe in the Lord Jesus Christ in the church. I'm telling the truth. Amen. When I was studying at Bible school, when I was being sponsored by the church where I was before, there was an old woman who always came to church. Not too old though. But this woman will always go to the pastor and will tell the pastor a lot of things. Or let me just say, he will, give the pastor a lot of work. She will go around looking for sick people. But she was doing the right time, though. She was doing the right thing. Looking for sick people. And then she will go tell Muruti, Muruti, there is someone who is sick. Every day, Muruti was busy. Every day. And then, to a certain time when Muruti felt that he's tired. He feels tired. And God revealed to him that this woman is not born again. Actually, the woman is in the other kingdom. She just wants to make you tired. Not everyone who does good things in the house of God. Amen. And then, now, because God was in control, the pastor called the old man. And asked, "Are you born again?" Now, because the Lord was in control, and the old man started confessing, "No, I'm not born again." Because the Lord had told the pastor that that woman is not born again. But the Lord did not tell the pastor that the woman is a Satanist. You see, God will protect us sometimes. He will not tell you, you know, in details, but he will just give you an idea of what is happening. I'm saying this because, you know, when Jesus Christ comes, he's coming for the church that is born again, the church that looks at him, that the church that has believed in him. Amen. So this is the time for the church to check themselves. This is the time for you to introspect yourself. You don't have to stress yourself. If you are born again, you know you are born again. Amen. Number two. Deal with the programmed strongholds of the mind. When you are born again now. Our pastor has been talking about this, the whole topic of, you know, the mind problems, and he's still continuing. Amen. The mind is a problem. This mind can make you lose your salvation. Because everything starts in the mind. When you are angry, your mind will start to tell you everything. Who to blame, what, who did this, we start to analyze, and the devil takes advantage of that. Amen. I'm not dwelling much on this one. The pastor is continuing preaching on it. Amen. But Paul says in Romans 12, verse 2. He says, "Do not conform to the patterns of this world." In other words, do not put your mind. Okay. Do not conform to the patterns of this world. But be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is. His good, pleasing and perfect will. Amen. So when you are born again, your mind needs to, you know, to be renewed by the word of God every time. Because what is in the mind, sometimes you can allow it to come to be an action. And now when it's an action, then we don't know what will happen after that. A lot of problem in your life. Amen. Number three. Get busy. I believe you are familiar with this, you know, phrase, get busy. Ephesians chapter 9, verse 10. It says, whatever your hands find to do it with all your might. For there is no work through, yes, there's no work throughout our knowledge or wisdom in Sheol. Am I reading properly? Whatever your hand finds to do it with your mind. For there is no work or thought or knowledge or wisdom in Sheol to which you are going. The writer of this book, he knows that we are going somewhere. One day we will be gone. Amen. Yes, one day we will be gone. I'm trying to remember a scripture with John who says, we are like grass. We are here this morning and evening we are, you know, set on fire. In other words, any person can go, Mr. Robert. Amen. Anytime a person can go. Hallelujah. So, we also learn that when we pass and we are taken to heaven, the works that we did on all the good works are going to be tested. That is why we must get busy. Amen. And are we busy with the right things or what? Amen. We need to be rich. We need to do everything which we can. But those things are not so important. That much. If God gives you an opportunity to be rich, yes, be rich, grab that wealth. But if you don't have those things, carry on with the work of God. Maybe your wealth is the work of God, what you are doing. Amen. Number four, which is the last one. It says, always run to the Lord for protection. Proverbs 18 verse 10 says, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. Temptations will come. Again, when it says, the name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run to it, and they are saved. We should always run to the Lord. Every time. Whether we are happy or not happy, we should run to the Lord. When temptations come, run to the Lord. Reject the devil. Amen. We are tempted. Everyone. Even pastors. Could have
Jesus Christ has gone through temptations.
Who
are we that we will not be tempted?
Amen. Ruth.
All of us.
Have you ever, I've seen a joke on Facebook. Where they were saying you were praying and you are having a good prayer, you are connected to the Lord. And suddenly your mind starts to think about something else. Which I can't just say it. Then I realized, yeah, the mind. It needs to be captured and controlled. Amen. Have you ever imagined things that after thinking about those things, you'll be shocked? What, was I the one thinking about this? Amen. We should run to the Lord. He's a strong tower. His name is a strong tower. Amen. Now, the word of God says the same thing. Every time, it says the same thing. For the wages of sin is death. It says the same thing to everyone. Whether you are the president, it says the same thing. Whether you are rich, it repeats the same thing. You are a pastor, the word of God says the same thing, that for the wages of sin is death.
And
so the Lord Jesus Christ is waiting for us. We need to prepare for us. We need to prepare ourselves for flight. Or else we are going to experience the great tribulation which was never experienced before. May God bless you. Amen.